Welcome to this week's North East Football Show. I'm Les Langley.
And I'm Steve Wraith. And this week, we're at the home of the famous Redhoof Boys Club, which produced Paul Gascoigne, Don Hutchinson, and many more.
So Steve, Redhoof Boys Club, why are we here?
We're here because it's a very important part of Gateshead's development of youngsters in football, and it's produced some really, really big names in the professional game. And, you know, it's a place that's close to my heart. I might be a Newcastle United fan, but I'm a Gateshead lad, lived in Gateshead all my life, and I've watched this place develop, and it's a fantastic facility, and it deserves a little bit of publicity.
I mean, even a Sunderland lad like myself's heard of Redhoof, but one of the things I've noticed, you look a bit down, to be fair.
I've got a hangover.
Were you out like at the weekend?
No, it's an FA Cup hangover.
Welcome to my world.
So what are you up to this week then, Les?
Well, obviously we had a FA Vars weekend, so I'm going to catch up with Martin Swales, the Sunderland RCA manager, as well as Gavin Cogden, the South Shields forward. Now, obviously we're going to have different levels there when I speak to those guys, because obviously one stayed in the cup and one's out, so...
Great stuff. Well, I'm going to obviously have a chat with Terry Ritson from Redhoof Boys. Also got Peter Ramage on the show and a crossbar challenge. But now I'm going to interview Terry Ritson. Terry, how long has Redhoof Boys been going?
Well, Redhoof Boys Club was formed in 1957. How it came about was it was actually a boxing club run by a guy called Billy Charlton. And another guy who was at the club called Bert Ronald. Asked Devon Brayson in 1957 if he could extend the club to a football club as well as a boxing club, and that's how the club was born.
Has it always been here in the heart of the teams?
It's been the heart of the teams with the different, obviously, venues in the teams, really. It started off at, I think, at Victoria Road, where the boxing club was. Then it had one first premises up we had was a double-decker bus as a clubhouse, but that didn't last long because it got broken and smashed up. But then... we moved to different parts of the teams, and we moved up to where it's called now Timeview School, but it was old Rose Street School. We had the building there from 1969-70, and we're there till about 2011. That's where the main club was born, really, you know, and where we developed from.
What's your role here, Terry?
I'm actually the senior sports coordinator, so I like coordinate all the like, junior soccer and... everything that's associated with the club, you know, football-wise, fundraising, grants, everything like that.
You've had lots of developments done here. I remember as a Sunday League player and a Sunday League manager playing on the pitches behind us with Felham Football Club, but you've really ploughed a lot of money into the place, really development, lovely pitches, lovely facilities, lovely training facilities. I know Dunstan train up here. You know, has it been hard to do?
Very, very hard. I mean, to be quite honest, I mean... started this dream about 20 years ago, trying to get this developed, and that was when we were at Rose Street School. And because I remember I used to get changed at the school and travel down to Smith Terrace to the games, you know. But we moved down here in 2011, which was just a set of changing rooms, really. Then we had to basically move it from there. Well, I'm saying 2011, we moved to the changing rooms in 2002, and then we had to move on from there, trying to find grants. Working with Gateshead Council to get what we needed, you know. Sport England, Football Foundation and all them things, you know.
Coming through the facilities in the clubhouse, there's some shirts on the wall, some very famous names have originated from Redhoof Boys Club. Tell us a little bit about them.
Yeah, well, the club's been very fortunate that, you know, we've had a lot of players come through here who've turned into professional game. The very first pro was a lad called Tommy Robson, who played with Newcastle and Chelsea. That was way back in the early 60s, way before I started coming here. I mean, I started here in 1970, the year after the junior side won the FA County Durham Youth Cup for the first time. And I've been here ever since. And then I've seen players come through here like Paul Gascoigne, Don Hutchinson, Graham Jones, Alan Dawson, David Hodgson, you know, they've all been through this club, you know. And even the Gateshead manager now, Neil Aspin, was at this club, you know. And Andy Carroll, who's at West Ham. You
know. Some big names, some great history at Red Hoof Boys. If you want to find out more about them, check out the website, and that address should be going along the bottom of the screen now. Terry Ritson, thanks very much for showing us around.
Thank you.
And now Les takes on Steve Pickering from Red Hoof Boys at the Crossbar Challenge.
Oh no, I'm under pressure already.
To be fair, I thought the first one was going to hit, so I'm quite happy with one.
So this week's crossbar challenge was an honourable draw. Lad, shake hands.
Well done.
Thanks, mate. Well done.
We've travelled through to Newcastle, the offices of Gary Forrest, the now ex-Shield manager. We're going to put one or two rumours to bed, but before I do that, this week's competition is a John Beresford signed pick. Now, to win that, you need to go onto our Facebook and Twitter pages and tell us where were me and Steve at the beginning of this week's show. So, Gary, the now ex-Shield manager, I just want to clear up one or two rumours. The first one was, I heard it was you'd resigned because going out with the Vase. And the other one was the sale behind your back. Can you let us know exactly what's happened, please?
To put the Vase stories to bed, they're quite ridiculous, to be honest. I've heard the rumours myself. I've read them on the social media that we've resigned because the Vase run's come to an end. I can assure everybody that had absolutely nothing to do with it. If anything, it made us more determined to retain the title. The players will tell you that. We all got together, the management team got together on the Monday. We had a chat about it, dusted ourselves down, says, right, let's go again. You can't build a football, your season strategy around a knockout competition. You have one bad day at the office and it's all over, which is exactly what happened to us. You need a bit of luck, you need a lot of good fortune, and you know, we just wouldn't do that. Our objective was to win the league title. So the Vase had absolutely nothing to do with it.
And the Ferguson transfer?
Well, yeah, obviously for 10 years we've had control of transfers and in and out at the football club, and that's obviously changed with the new chairman coming in. That's his prerogative. He's obviously got a different agenda. It's his football club, he's the chairman. And I think, you know, he wants to do things his way, maybe take more control of transfers, I don't know. But, you know, when somebody's sold from behind your back and you genuinely don't know about it, then you can't stay at a football club.
So when did you know about this transfer?
After it was done. You know.
I mean, you've been there for 10 years, so I know you spoke off camera about how nice the people at Children are, and you've had a lot of good words to say for them. Well, that must have hurt.
Of course it did. I mean, you know, we've put 10 and a half, 11 years worth of hard work into that football club. The football club's gone from the brink of extinction to league champions. It's been transformed both on and off the football pitch. You know, we've met some fantastic people, but it's not just the sacrifices made by me, Stuart, Phil and Keith Finch, etc., and Dean the physio. It's the sacrifices our family made during that period of time as well. You know, not going on holidays or cutting holidays short. We even had to get married in June because pre-season was starting. You know, that sort of sacrifice. People, it goes missing. So a lot of people sacrificed a lot for the football club. And at the end of the day, you know, football's football. Nothing surprises me. I think we deserved a little bit more respect than that we were afforded at the time. But we leave there with our heads held high. We love the football club. The people in there are absolutely fantastic. You know, and like I say, we leave it in a very good, very healthy position, and hopefully they'll push on from here.
And Bobby Mills obviously took over as manager as well as playing still, yeah?
So I'm hurt, yeah. You know, it's what him and the chairman obviously wanted all along. They've got what they wanted. So they've made the bed, they need to lie on it. It's down to the pair of them now to go and deliver some results, both on and off the pitch. You couldn't ask for a better start, to be honest with you. First managerial job, and you've got the teams that third in the league, two quarter finals, second division clubs, both at home. So you couldn't ask for a better start to your managerial career. So let's hope he can go and deliver some silverware for them this season. But he's got what he wanted.
Well, you're leaving as the current league champion, so I hope it hasn't left too much of a sour taste in your mouth. But thanks, good luck with whatever it is you do.
Okay,
thank
cheers.
You.
That's it for part one in the North East Football Show. Join us in part two, where I talk to Peter Ramage and Les talks all things FA Vars.